Good morning. Yeah. Today is a Sunday morning and I take pleasure in welcoming all of you for the introduction of the annual lecture series that we want to introduce as part of the National Program on the Education of the Gifted and the Talented. We are extremely pleased that we have with us Mr. Sriram Raghavan, who would be talking to us about artificial intelligence and its future. Just a couple of sentences about the program. The National Program on the Education of the Gifted and the Talented was launched at NIAS in 2011. We spent the first 3-4 years just trying to develop tools to identify children who are gifted and talented. The research pointed out to the complexity of being able to identify these children from diverse backgrounds, and the research continues. But during the process of research, it became extremely important for us to mentor and provide some kind of support for these children who are identified as gifted and talented. We started off the program conducting summer and winter workshops for these children. We were not very happy with the form of mentoring that these children got. We worked with IISE very closely with the students at the master's and the doctoral level to provide one-to-one mentoring to children who were slightly older in common areas of interest. Not very happy even with that kind of support. That is when last year I actually met Sudarshan and we decided to launch the NIAS supported advanced learning centers in schools in Bangalore and Hyderabad because they were our partner schools. Currently we have 3 centers, one for Bangalore North, one for Bangalore South, and one in Hyderabad. The centers operate on Saturdays or Sundays for a period of 3 to 5 hours, and the children spend time in these centers basically trying to explore their areas of interest and follow a curriculum that is beyond what formal education can give them. Along with the advanced learning centers, we are also doing periodic summer and winter workshops for these children so that we are able to take them to the next level. The advanced learning center has just completed 1 year and we are very happy with the progress that we have made. The following year, we are looking at how do we scale these centers in terms of having multiple centers. The advanced learning centers operate in a way that the school that hosts the center would provide us the infrastructural facilities. They also take care of the remuneration of the facilitators. They give us the infrastructure, but the center would have children from neighborhood schools. NIAS is extremely particular that the composition of these children should be from diverse socioeconomic backgrounds, and we constantly do that check to make sure that that is met, including the gender balance, as well as the other aspects that we think that will make the group extremely diverse, which I think would be a good strength. Along with that, the school that actually hosts the center has the flexibility of using the resources and the knowledge generated here to strengthen their school activities during the other parts of the weekday. The only thing that what NIAS holds on is the screening process is controlled by NIAS in a sense to make sure that it is fair and we are able to get really the bright kids. And we also make sure that the curriculum framework is also driven from NIAS. Along with it, we are trying to create a content for the children of this program, which are basically in interdisciplinary areas to give them an exposure of what the future would hold for them in terms of the varied subjects and the varied challenges that we have. I would want to stop right here and actually ask Kalesa Elvi to just speak a few words of why Vidyashilp got into partnership with NIAS and what did she think it did to the program and the school.
Thank you. On behalf of VSA, Vidyashilp Academy, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to the special group, I would say. Special group for the simple reason, I think the past 1 year, the kind of attitude that the students have demonstrated on Sunday is absolutely inspiring. Dr. Sudarshan says like the session was scheduled between 9 to 12. Interestingly, most of the days they have stayed back till 1:30. I think that speaks volumes about the engagement and involvement that these students have shown. For Vidyashilp, I think we strongly believed and we were staunch followers of Dr. Gardner's theory, saying that every child is endowed with multiple intelligence and we need to tap on something that's dominant. So Vidyashilpa has always looked at how to open the doors for children to look at what they are good at and how to tap on that. And at that time, I think Professor Anita Kurup's initiative on gifted education definitely came in as a breather. We were always troubled by the fact that, at least for Vidyashilpa Academy, the formative years, we pioneered something that was very non-conventional, and we really wanted education to be meaningful and relevant for students. In the formative years, kids were extremely excited with the conceptual knowledge, looking at their talent pool. We wanted to see how we could sustain that in their middle years and high school as well. At some point in time, we definitely realized the talent that surfaced in the formative years, somewhere I'm not too sure whether it is a generalization, but we felt there was a saturation and we did not see that honing itself to the optimum that we wished. It was then certain things bothered us also. Why is that? Like, there is this notion, India is an island of excellence and oceans of mediocrity. Could we do something about it? With that intention, we wanted to look at all that the present children need is the right mentors. They do have the potential, they have the intellectual capacity. The resources that they have is a lot more than what it was a few decades back. With that, how could we put all these things together is what we wanted to do. With that, our connection with NIAS began. The first lot of 25 students, when we met, including Parikrama children, the attitude and perseverance that they showed signaled to us a lot. Definitely, most of our teachers who are involved are impacting the 2000 demography of Vidyashil. The second screening of gifted education identified about 25 students of Vidyashil to engage in activity during the school day. Interestingly, those 25 students are kind of creating a urge for 200 children of that particular grade wanting to know why they were not chosen for it. We see that as a beginning of a snowball effect that will be created, and India will certainly look at honing the potential of children, and in the true spirit, Vidyashilp will contribute along with other schools in creating a curriculum that will enable all children of India to thrive at their best. On that note, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to all the guests here and all the students and parents. Thank you.
Let me invite Prashok to introduce Mr. Sriram Raghavan, and then we'll go on.
Good morning, everyone. When this idea of TED Talk series came, the first name that came to our mind was Sriram, and that's for two reasons. Number one, he and his team is primarily like developing some of the amazing like AI capability and AI assets in IBM, and they were trying to solve that at scale on various the industries, be it retail, be it telecommunication, be it banking, finance, or whatever things. And they have the best of the talent, and they were trying to solve this as we speak. So it is not theory, it was trying to solve the problems at scale. And the second most important part is that, so if you just look at his academics, that includes IIT and Stanford, and we thought like there's no better person who can come and share like his insight in terms of the grind what he has gone through personally, and what he can share, you know, as an insight to like all the budding stars here, so that they can actually orient themselves and they can just get prepared for the big event in life. So we were trying to just mix both AI and B, obviously learning his personal story and also the grind and the fun he has gone through. So that is the reason why we thought Sriram is the ideal person. As an IBMer, he's the most inspirational person for us, and we look upon him for almost every, you know, the complex problems. Unfortunately, we don't get enough of him because he's traveling most of the time. So we end up like, watching his YouTube over and again. And when this particular issue came, I just text him. I just chanced upon him because I knew that like most of the times he's out of the country. I asked Sriram, I mean, we are launching this particular program. Would you mind just coming and spending your time with the kids? His response was like in split second. He said, guys, just let me know when and where. And here he is. Thanks, Sriram.
Good morning, my distinct pleasure to be here. I'm hoping to not make this a lecture and actually make this an interactive workshop. So I will occasionally go there to show you something I think will add value. But what I'm actually hoping to do is give you a sense of, little bit of sense of both history and future. Because there's always, I can always talk about what's happening in AI today, but that's not very interesting. What's more interesting is what you guys are going to do in AI tomorrow. So I'm going to share some aspirations and hopefully challenging problems which you guys can take on. I also want to give you a sense of history because I think we have to learn quite a bit. We have to learn quite a bit from the fact that humanity tried AI before, then we did, we stopped worrying about it for a while, then we started liking it again. Why? What happened? What changed? I think it's important for that. So I'm going to start there. But before I begin, let me do a little bit of poll and get you all warmed up. For the students, I'm not going to ask the parents here, how many have written what they think is an AI program? I heard there were a few. Has anybody written an AI program? Something that has used AI? Okay. Anybody read about it, watched a YouTube video, tried to understand what AI is? Okay. There are a few. So I'm going to pick on somebody who raised their hands and ask for a reaction. So, yes, your problem is you overestimate your teachers, but that's what people want. Tell me what you think is AI, and I will repeat so that everybody hears.
AI, I think,
is
something that can be intelligent like human beings and mimic some of the activities they do.
So, and that's a good definition, but I want to start with a little bit of history. So, let's start with a little bit of what happened with AI first, because I think that's a good place to start. Okay, actually I'm going to go here.
So, this is a little bit of context, and why we are also interested in AI is, I hope you can read some of that text here. Most of you know what the Industrial Revolution is? Okay. Most of you can read the fact that everything here, steam and railways, steel, electricity, oil, these were all major, major innovations that changed the way the world worked. Industrial Revolution changed the way goods were produced. That's what we all talk about it, and I'm sure in your history class you spend months learning about what happened. The invention of steam and railways completely changed transportation in terms of how much. Same with steel electricity, same with oil. Most recent innovation has been what we all call information technology, right? Our computers, chips, supercomputers, smartphones. That's this most recent information and telecommunication revolution. But what has happened, why we are all excited about AI is, we actually tried to do AI somewhere here. We tried, and I will tell you, in 1956 was when the world was fine. So what is 1956 to 2018? We're talking over 60 years. For 6 years, nothing happened. Because we tried it a little too early, and I will tell you why. But now we believe AI is going to be the next big revolution. And the reason why we believe now is the right time is because of this thing called data. So I'll first start with data, and then I'll tell you why now is the right time. But I just want to give you this context that we think this is as big. We don't think AI is like a little product or a piece of software or some little innovation. We think it's going to change almost every part of how the world works. So the world that most of you are going to inhabit over the next 50, 60 years is going to be transformed much in the same way that each of us was transformed. So that's the starting point. So let me go back to when we started to try to do AI for the first time. So AI was coined actually in 1950. There was a conference in a place called Dartmouth in the US where there was this guy called John Picard who first said, we should attempt. By that time they had computers. Computers were being used to add up numbers, keep records. They used it for counting numbers in elections. They were using it for basic counting. And a bunch of things were happening. But they said, look, we should try to Why should computers only do computation, which is only one of the many things human beings do? I don't spend all my day just adding up numbers. I sense, I reason, I speak, I communicate. Why can't I get a machine to do all that? So they coined the word and they tried for a really long time. Until in the last decade, last 10 to 15 years, they didn't succeed at all. And the reason, and that's why I have this picture of this knee freeze, because it sort of went into culture. Nobody worried about it, nobody talked about it. And in fact, you were a scientist, a computer scientist or a mathematician working on AI, you could ask why are you bothered? Not going to go anywhere, go change your discipline, go with something. But it all changed in the last 10 to 15 years for a couple of reasons. So, and these reasons are important to understand. Ignore the numbers, but like almost anything in computers, there are three things that make up an AI. The first thing is, what is the AI operator? What the AI operates on, the fuel, is data. Data could be anything. Data could be the words in it. The data could be all your photos. The data could be all the readings that a doctor takes when I go into a clinic. The data could be, you know, measurements about the energy usage of the day over the day. Whatever the data is. But that's the first ingredient. So you're trying to make an AI, your first ingredient is data. When they tried it the previous time, the problem was there wasn't enough data. There wasn't enough data for a problem. And so it was like trying to say, I'm going to show a machine a few examples of it. And then the machine has to figure out what that means. I'm going to show a machine three readings, and then the machine suddenly has to understand the energy physics just from looking at three readings. You can't do that. Even we as human beings can't do that. So there wasn't enough data in the form that computers could understand. So that was one reason they ran into a problem. They happily invented a lot of algorithms as a technique, right? That's your design. Hopefully most of you know what an algorithm is. So that's your software program, your logic, what. And there were lots and lots of ideas there, but they didn't have this. And they had a big problem, which is their algorithms required a lot of computing power. And at that time, computing power was very expensive. So what this chart shows is actually how the cost of storing data has dropped and how the available storage has dramatically improved. Forget about the numbers, but over the last, from 1956 to now, what has happened is, these two have been addressed. It's very easy. Any of you, by the way, for pocket change, can get more compute power on Amazon or Microsoft or Google or IBM Cloud for what it would cost to build cities even 15 years ago. That's how cheap computers become. And now, there is more data. Some of you may have smart devices, some of you may use an iPad at home or computer at home. There's probably enough data in there, which is more than the data that AI researchers had 30, 40 years ago, just sitting on your palm of your hand. So that's what actually changed this data in. And now we were able to apply all those techniques that never worked for 60, 70 years, and now we try and look at all those techniques again, and it's how to see how to do it. So that's the big history lesson.
So when you start thinking about artificial intelligence, why it's starting to get exciting?
Now, what has happened? Why are we all excited right now? It is not just that we think it works, it is actually starting to work. Many of you experience AI in your personal life today. With Siri or with your smartphone, you're able to speak. Some of you may have Alexa or Google Home. You experience this at home today. But AI is much more than what you experience. But the reason you experience all that is, these things are possible. Today, machines are able to translate languages. Machines are able to take speech. You can put a machine in there, it understands what I said, it can turn it into text. Not perfectly, but good enough. Machines are able to understand language. That's how your smartphone understands what language. Machines are able to reason, I will come to that. Any of you have seen examples where a machine is able to recognize images? Anybody can give me an example? Yes? I'm going to go to somebody else. You. Okay, your face detection. Yes. Face recognition. So, these things work. But I have used a word here called narrow. So, these are all examples where a problem has been very well defined. So the machine was told, your job is to identify players on the screen. Your job is to identify faces. So you identify the problem. Then you gave the machine lots and lots and lots and lots of data. Billions of data, billions of data points. You told it what it wanted. So somebody decided to tell the machine what a face looks like. And then what did the machine do? That's where the artificial intelligence. He said, okay, based on all these examples, I now know how to recognize an image. So now you give me another photo or another image, I know how to do it. So it's narrow because today where we are in artificial intelligence is you need three things. You need a clear problem. You need lots of data for that problem. And then you need a lot of compute power for the machine to go learn from that data and learn how to do that activity. So that's narrow AI. The reason I'm going to mention this is as you are all looking to invent new things, I'm going to challenge you to build what I call broad AI. And we'll give you a few challenges later on about what broad AI is. But just hold on to say this is what we are all excited. So today, narrow AI works. It's working. We are all experiencing lots of products. And I'm going to give you a few interesting examples of AI in action. Because what I want to do is take away from this business that this is all AI. So I want to show you how AI is actually impacting useful applications.
Okay, let's skip this.
So I'm going to start with one area where Prashok and I work together quite a bit. This is detail and fashion. Is it possible to get any connectivity to the
room?
Yes. Yes. If it is, that'd be great because I'd like to show some of the live videos. Wi-Fi is possible?
Yeah.
That'd be great.
Or let me just do this. Let me just do my Wi-Fi hotspot.
I'm going to give you examples from very few different areas where one common theme is in all of these cases, the AI is looking at some form of image. But in each case, it's doing very, very different things from different types of images. So the first image is fashion. Everybody, at least some of you, I don't, but maybe some of you like shopping for clothes. Across the world, a lot of people like shopping for clothes. And what people want to do is give you a better and better experience when you shop for clothes. And when I say clothes and stuff from fashion, shoes, jewelry, handbag, and everything that you use. Now, what we'd like to do is we'd like to teach the machine two things. We'd like to teach the machine how to understand words that have to do with fashion. How do I teach the machine what a t-shirt is? To be able to recognize that a piece also means t-shirt. What does it mean for something to be a graphic t-shirt? What does it mean for something to be a sweatshirt? What does it mean for something to be a Banarasi sari? Okay. So in other words, when I write it in text, the machine should know what that means. So that's one we have to teach the machine. The second way I have to teach the machine is, suppose I just click a picture of one of you. Can the machine take that image and then break it apart to say, okay, that guy was wearing a graphic red t-shirt with a Stanford logo. He is wearing a gray pant. He is wearing, I don't know what the shoe is, etc. Can the machine do that automatically? So why would this be useful? Because the machine can do that automatically. Imagine the type of experience that I could give a shopper. And this is what one of the companies wanted to do. So I'm going to roll a little video.
I don't think it has sound right now, but just watch what happens.
Just navigate. So what the company wanted to do was allow people to use their app to clip pictures of whatever they like. So I was walking on the road, I like this guy's video. So you clip a picture, upload it. And then you come in and don't type anything. You just search by showing examples. So you see what's happening. It picked this picture from the company's catalog. The machine picked up all the shirts that look like this. Now it will go change something. It will click on something else. You're navigating, you're searching. It will show you all the images. And it will keep doing this for you. Basically, you are searching through the catalog. If you keep watching this video while I speak, it will do this for shoes. You are searching through the catalog of the company, not by typing anything in here, but basically saying, I took all these pictures of stuff that I like. I'm going to buy something based on what. But imagine trying to describe this. It's very, very hard to describe. You'll have to write a big passage to describe it, even then it won't be perfect. Now, what you're allowing you to do is to show an example. By the way, that's how human beings communicate. If I wanted to explain to my, so let's say my daughter was here and I wanted to explain, hey, remember next time you go shopping, I want that shirt. I wouldn't sit and describe that shirt with blue, stripes, this, that. I would just say, hey, remember this? She will remember it. What she and I have both of them is created this mental model and we will know how to do it. This is what the machine does. And I don't know if you notice, You can even take a big picture, like you're doing factories, you can just mark off a small portion and the system will recognize just the theme. So essentially what happened here was, without typing anything at all, based on the fact that the AI here is able to understand images of people wearing clothes, you basically did it and you have checked, this is your catalog, you flick signs of it, shop. Now, you may ask, okay, is this really important? Is this worth it? Not really. But the reason I started here is I'm going to change, give you other examples which are going to be truly world changing. But the point is, at its core, what did the AI do? Since we are talking about what AI does, AI did two things. In this example, the AI learned how to really understand images. And it did that from arbitrary images taken in the world. And it is very, very complicated. So one challenge that I'm going to pose for whoever is interested in this. Build a, if you know coding, pick your favorite language. Build a system that is at least able to detect whatever is the dominant color of the top that somebody is wearing. So I'll give you some picture, I'll give you a picture only of one human being, and you guys can take photos within your family. Your job is automatically detect the most important color, because you may have multiple colors in the shirt, right? What's the most important color of the top that the human being is wearing? You will realize that that alone is actually a hard problem. It's a hard problem because images are not taken perfectly. Images are taken from various angles, even knowing what a shirt is. And by the way, you will not start from scratch. There are existing APIs that will let you do detection of a face. So you can take an image, you can use existing services, remove the face, remove the body, you will only be left with a shirt. Then you have to do some analysis. See whether you're doing. It's not an easy task, but it's a task where if you know programming, in a couple of months you can do something. And that's a small piece of what you need to do, but that's something you need.
Okay, slightly different experience. Now I'm going to play this video, watch what happens here.
Just watch, something is getting typed and something changes at the bottom, there's no audio. Just watch this. Just watch, it said black piece, you only got black t-shirts. Now, you say black graphic piece, all the t-shirts which don't have a graphics on them will go away, you only have graphic pieces. Then, black graphic print piece for my niece. By the way, that actually has a spelling which they bother sometimes. Even then, it suddenly decided to throw away all the images of boy because it said niece is there. And then under 1K, under 1000, already. So here is on sale. So I want you to think about what all the AI is doing here. Okay? The AI is doing three or four different things. One, AI is understanding text. It understands things, it understands graphic, it understands needs, it understands 1K, it understands on sale. That's one. We already talked about the fact that on all of these images, the AI understands. The AI knows in this picture that there is a graphic, it probably even knows the size, it knows what is printed there, the style, material, etc. It knows from the image. And then it is matching. It basically understands your text, it understands your image, it starts to match. It said, oh, this guy only wanted knees. Oh, okay, fine, I have to throw away the stuff. This one said only graphics, so I should throw away all the images. So think about what the AI is doing. AI is understanding a domain. The domain here happens to be the domain of fashion and dresses. But it understands the domain independent of whether it is being written in text or shown in image. By the way, all the human beings do it all the time. Here I am chatting with you. I could take this mug, point at it. You and I, you will process my voice. If I point to signboard, you will process the text on the signboard. If I point to an image, you and I are able to have a conversation in what is called multimodal. Means we are using all modes. I'm using voice, I'm pointing, I'm looking at objects, I'm pointing at text. Getting computers to do multimodal is very hard. This is like a starting example of how to get computers to do. So computers to do multimodal, they need to understand that this is black, that word black is also black. Which we automatically assume human beings know how to do. have to be pretty hard for computers. So that's an example of what AI does. So three things: it's understanding images, it's understanding text, and it's understanding problems.
Okay.
I could go for another, but I'm going to go shift gears into a different vertical. This is something maybe in a future session you can show them a video of. We did similar work here in Dubai. You will find it very interesting. I'm just going to show you a small piece of this.
So you see the art of the possible. I'm just not going to show you the whole video. The interesting part I'm just going to quickly go through. Okay.
Everybody probably knows who this is. But the point here was, what the AI doing here is the following. You can sit in front of this machine, take a picture of yourself, just you know, any iPhone, iPad, whatever. Take a picture. You can put click on a piece of jewelry, and out will pop how the jewelry looks to you. You are not wearing the jewelry. The jewelry is not even with you. The jewelry is sitting in a catalog somewhere. You are sitting in front of an iPad. You can figure out how the jewelry looks. Now think about how hard that is. Because what do I have to do? Given an image, I have to figure out where your neck is. It's pretty hard. Then I have to take the jewelry, figure out how the jewelry has to be oriented. Because I can't have this sitting on the nose, right? This has to hang here. It has to go this way. Essentially, the AI is virtually draping jewelry on top of it. So, it's an interesting example, and I'm going to stop here because I could keep going many, many examples. So, one takeaway for you is, one thing AI does is understand new forms of data. Before AI, you had to do all the hard work to represent the data in a way a computer could understand. So you probably know that almost everything is automated, right? So companies know how many products I sold, how much money I made, because they recorded all of the computer. In those cases, everything is written down in a way that computers understand. You take data, you store it nicely in columns, and then the computer knows. Here with AI, you don't do anything. You deal with it like you deal with human beings. You show it pictures, you point it, speak it, and it is able to understand. So, understanding what is called unstructured data, which is images, videos, pictures, that's one important thing AI does. And until recently, it was very, very hard for computers to understand unstructured data. So, that's sort of the big takeaway.
Let's go to a different domain.
Completely different domain. It also has lots of images. I'm going to give you an example from a web. Everybody loves food. We all have to eat. Anybody have a sense of how many farms there are in India? Anybody know the number? Why guess? Somebody? Sorry?
5 lakhs.
5 lakhs, way more than that. Way more than that. There are, yes?
5 million.
We're getting there. But still bigger than that. Add 2 more digits to it. There are actually 200 million plus farms depending on how you count it. Okay? And if you look at the number of people who depend on farming for livelihood, that's pretty much half the country. Because for every farmer, his kids and his wife depend on it, right? And there's a big. So like half of our country depends on farming. Now, and you might be surprised, what has AI got to do with farming? Farming is I go digging the soil, plant a seed, water it, and human stuff comes out. It's true. But the challenge is, how do you do it well? We keep having many, many people on the planet, but the amount of land on the planet remains the same. In fact, there is less land for farming because we are constructing more buildings. So the challenge we have is, how to get more food to feed everybody from the same available piece of land, which means we have to use it intelligently. We have to get more out of the piece of land so that I can actually feed everybody. And do it in a healthy way, sustainable way, so that the food is, you know, healthy for you. Now, one of the challenges, that's why I asked an India question, is in some of the emerging countries, we take a country like America, you'll have lots of farms, but the farms will be very, very big. So you will have one or two farmers with a lot of equipment farming hundreds of acres. Whereas here in India, on average, a farmer, on average, yeah, there may be rich farmers with lots of land, but an average farmer has half hectare to 1 hectare. I hope most of you know what a hectare is. If not, that's homework assignment. But it's relatively small. So now the question is, now what does that mean? What that means that I have to give the farmer the ability to say what to do on his or her farm so that they can get the best. What to sow, when, what nutrients to apply, when to irrigate. And today, even though we have been doing farming for thousands of years, many farmers today only use some policies that they learned from their fathers that typically you do this, you just follow. You're not using any science or instrumentation, you just follow better. So the question we wanted to ask was, is there a way to get technology so that we can understand a farm better? Can I understand at any given point of time what is the nutrient, how much phosphorus, how much nitrogen, what is sitting in the soil? Can I understand what's the moisture content? I could overwater unnecessarily, or I may not realize that I have to water. You can't tell just by looking at what's in the surface. You have to look at where the plant is getting water out of. Now, there are two ways to do it. In mature, in big countries, if the farmer is rich and owns a lot of land, I can tell the farmer, buy this fancy tractor. Buy this fancy tractor with a lot of sensors. The tractor will go around your farm. While it goes around the farm, the sensors will collect all the information. I will process all the data and I will tell you what. That's not affordable. A farmer who has half hectare of land, you can't tell him to buy a fancy tractor to cross, you know, 5 acres. It's not possible. So the question here is the following. I can't afford to put lots of sensors on the ground. It's just not practically possible. I have to contact 200 million farmers to do that. But there is a sensor that is constantly looking at the earth. That these, actually many, many sensors, these sensors live roughly 36,000 kilometers above the surface. Can anybody tell you what those sensors are? So now, luckily I remember the 36,000 from my high school of the orbital radius. Now, right now there are over 600 satellites constantly, I believe, circling the earth that we know of. There may be other secret satellites, but there are at least 500 to 600 constantly. Every satellite, what is it doing? It's like a camera. It is just that the camera only doesn't use the frequency of visible light. It uses all sorts of infrared, ultraviolet, radar imagery. It uses all sorts of technology, but basically it's a camera. It's a camera. There are 600 of those cameras constantly circling, taking photographs of the earth. So the question is, can we do AI on those photographs to figure out something useful that a farmer can have? That is right. For example, can I use all the images? But here is the problem. Unlike a sensor that I control, unlike a camera where I decide where to point to, I can't control. The satellite has been launched, it's going to circle, it's going to do what it is going to do. If I take a photograph of a piece of land exactly when there is cloud, so its photograph will be blurry. It will come and visit my piece of land only once every 2 weeks, because maybe the acceptance is once every 2 weeks. Some other satellite will circle once every other week. Some other satellite will take it with high resolution, somebody will take it with closer resolution. So the question is, can I use AI on all those photographs? That is again data, but a different kind of data. It's not data of images and t-shirts, it's data of whatever the satellite is. Can I use it to do things, look under? Can I sit from 36,000 feet above and look and figure out what the moisture content is 1 meter below the soil? Answer is with AI, you can. So we are able to, using AI on satellite data, build a model so accurate that it will be able to tell you 1 feet or 2 feet below the soil what the moisture content is. So that we can make a decision on whether you should water, not water, stop watering, you are underwatering. So I'm going to show you two videos here just to give you a sense of what's possible. So that's one technology. The other technology is a different use of AI, which is called AgroPlan. I'm going to show the video and then we'll come. Okay.
So will there be sound if I play a video? Do you know? It'll be okay.
With over 50% of the total population engaged in agricultural activities, agriculture is the backbone of India. The 1.3 million people in the country survive and thrive on their own crops as well. With sufficient support, agro-tech ecosystem can be transformed to attain prosperity. IBM Research is developing new innovations leveraging technologies like artificial intelligence, machine learning, data analytics, and cloud to drive the transformation and future of the agriculture sector. Our research supports agriculture by helping to increase farm productivity, monetize the crop output properly, reducing the volatility of production, and giving farmers easy access to capital. Technologies like remote sensing, AI, IoT, and visual analytics are being used to produce crops more sustainably and increase productivity. IBM's AI-powered precision agriculture solutions include advisories and insights to help improve farming outcomes and enable organizations associated with agriculture and food
So I'm going to pause here. The two examples of what AI does. The first is what's called crop health monitoring. So here is the basic idea. Just to give you a sense, what does a satellite do? Predict good crop probably is green, bad crop is not green. Fair enough, roughly speaking. Red bad crop will be yellow. Now, green crop, essentially, the characteristic of green color is when a satellite puts light on it, it will reflect light well in the near infrared and a little bit in the visible. Whereas, if people know infrared, visual, frequency, wavelength, properly speaking, right? So, good crop, that is green looking stuff, will reflect a different set of frequencies from stuff that is either decaying or not doing well, right? Yellow color or, you know, red color. So basically what a satellite is doing is sending light to these frequencies, measuring the reflected light back. Now the problem I have is that the satellite is going to do it far, so far away. The satellite, many, many satellites are going to do it, and that measurement will be affected by whether the reflected goes through a cloud or does not go through. So the role of AI is essentially to clean all this data. And it will produce a number which is called a vegetation health index. It will basically let you, and today, I don't have the time today, I can show you a map of India where every pixel roughly represents a farm. I can click on that pixel and I can show you how the health of the farm was over the last as many years as there have been satellites. So think of how useful and powerful this is. The government could use it to understand where to spend money. The farming companies could decide which parts are doing well, which parts are not doing well. Think about how easy it is compared to the only other option is to go around driving down all those farms and deciding who is doing what is doing, what is not doing. So this is very powerful. The second one I put is soil moisture. Look, plants often, this may be a bad picture, plants suck up water from somewhere here, not just water here, right? So what the AI is able to do is, again, all satellites' shine frequencies get stuff cut. But what gets reflected is determined by the composition of the soil and whether there is water. So what the AI is doing is learning how the presence or absence of water here affects what gets reflected. That's what the AI is learning. And once it is able to learn, it will come back and tell you, here is this is 85% moisture content, this is 93% moisture content further down. And different plants need moisture at different levels because their roots are not all the same. So now I can tell you what to first plant where, or if you are planting something here, it is deficit with water because at the level at which the plant needs water, there is no moisture in the soil. That's what you are able to do. You are able to avoid doing all that with plugging sensors. So the lesson here is that you hear also
images, but a very different type of image. So I'm going to show you this other picture now. This is a different use case.
This does not use our satellites, it's different.
Chemical analysis today is very complex and time consuming.
So what have they done here? How have they used AI here? This is not satellite, but you want to understand nutrient content, phosphorus, nitrogen, or whatever is in there in the soil that is important. The problem is small farmers, goes back to our 150-200 million.
they can't afford to spend a lot of money to do, take soil samples, send it to a major chemical factory, get it analyzed and so on. So what this technology does is, you just take a little bit of your soil, mix it with water, put it on that piece of paper. This is like those of you who have seen people do diabetic tests at home, you know they have a special pad on which they drop a piece of blood. Very much the same thing. But what it is a special piece of paper which has these four dots that you can't see. When they turn it around, there were four circles. Each of those four circles will turn into a specific color, very in a very specific pattern based on what that underlying nutrient is. What the AI is doing here is learning how to understand how those four colors will look like based on different amounts of nutrients. So what it is learning is a model that says, if there is 56% phosphorus, these four circles will look like this. If there is 83% nitrogen, these four circles will look like this. That's the model. Now why is this powerful for a farmer? All they need is their paper and the smartphone. They don't have to have a chemical laboratory at all. They can literally do this as often, as frequently as they want. Very, very powerful, saves money, reduces cost. So look at these examples here. They were all about images, but just different kinds of images. And how does the AI work? The AI works by eventually turning all the images into numbers. So eventually the AI is some piece of mathematics or statistics operating on numbers. The challenge in each case is how do you turn those images into the numbers and what is the algorithm or statistics that you compute on the numbers. But the point to take away is, when you open up your mind, don't think of AI only as what you hear in movies, which is, you know, this alien being talking to you. That's fine, but there is a lot of useful AI you can do, very, very practical, all based on the fact that you can teach AI to understand interesting images. You can teach AI to understand interesting text, you can teach AI to understand interesting text. These are all the same, and by the way, all three examples, the fashion one, the agro one where it's processing satellite data, and this one which is looking at the paper, they all use the common class of things. So it's not as if you have to learn it. Some of you might have known about this technique called neural networks. Some of you may have heard of this word called neural network. If you have not, go look them up. What neural network, and all of them use this technology called deep neural networks. What are neural networks? It goes back to what our friend said first. We are trying to mimic the brain. So neural networks are where you try to create a network in the computer, where each node in that network, we try to imitate a neuron. You're all aware that our brain is made up of neurons with synapses connecting them, and that's how we process. So we try to create in the computer a digital representation of a neuron. We create a big network of billions of nodes, and we try and teach the network to do one of these things. So what somebody in my lab did is built a network whose only job is, given an image, learn how to figure out what the t-shirt, pant, jeans, etc. Somebody else in the lab said, given an image, which is satellite image, I will tell you what the vegetation index and soil moisture is. Somebody else in my Brazil lab said that, given this image, I will tell you this image of a paper, I will tell you what is not. All of them are using the same underlying technology, but the use is very, very different. And all of this is also artificial.
Okay, so there's many more things I could do, but I wanted to go slightly, you know, give you a broader perspective. So I'm going to move off of agriculture, but I'm just going to show you a few slides that show you these really matter. We're not joking here, that really matters. I went through some of this stuff.
Just give you an example. What the AI did, all of these are satellite images. There are about 50,000 of them over every piece of land. What the AI does is turns it into a high resolution satellite. This is an example of a satellite where the satellite took the data, this whole thing was covered in cloud. This was one where there were some other impurities in the atmosphere. This one was a little bit better. What the AI did was combine all this into a data. Here, when I compute vegetation index, it becomes highly accurate. That's what we were talking about.
And this all matters, okay?
So we did some work, actually here in India. Everybody loves potatoes, French fries, other forms of potatoes. One of the most popular crops. And blight is something affects potatoes. And it can destroy, this is something I don't understand, we learn how blight affects. And give you an example, there are apparently two forms of blight, late blight and early blight. Look at what late blight can do, it can take a rich thing like this and turn it into a complete messed up form. Early blight can destroy, and this will happen in a matter of 5 to 10 days. Now, once it has hit it, you cannot do much. you're given, you're just trying to save what you can. So what does a farmer need? The farmer needs to know about 7-10 days in advance that I'm likely to get right. And it's like, you know, why is, once you, as soon as you start getting a cough, I should medicate you, otherwise I shouldn't wait to until you have 133 degrees. I should take some whatever, either medication or compress or whatever home remedies I should do earlier. What we try are doing is using all the technology, vegetation, health, soil, weather, etc. We are trying to give advisories to farmers. Right here we tell them, you are going to suffer early blight. Here is the intervention that we should do. So that means we ensure that that doesn't happen. And the good news is it's possible to do. Here is an example of a pilot where left side, the farmer, it's a control experiment. The farmer listened to our advice, sees something. There we let it do whatever happens. And this is AI in action. Both were farmers right there saying they were good. Experiment, not as if this farmer didn't listen, it was a controlled experiment to show that you can act. We were able to predict late blight 7 to 14 days in advance. So the farmer was able to take action, put in the right, in this case, whatever, you know, pesticide or other intervention he had to do. And that was the right we didn't do, and we were actually able to save the farmer.
Okay. This one is interesting. I think you should see this. This hints at a type of AI that I think is increasingly starting to happen. So far, for our AI trying to do something we as human beings could have done, but it would have taken a lot of humans, a lot of time, and we could not have done it at scale. But there is something we human beings do, which is we consider creative, right? Making music, writing poems, designing clothes, creating movies. These are all things we think is creative. It's not boring task. Somebody has a cool idea, they come up with a nice approach, a nice style. And people are also trying to figure out, can AI be their help or AI starting to get creative? So there are many examples of AI starting to get creative. And this is a very tough question because nobody quite knows what is creative. So there have been examples where an AI was shown a lot of music. And it was asked to create another musical piece based on the substance. It created something. You could argue you like it, you didn't like it. Is it being creative? I don't know. But I think the following is already happening, which is AI helping creative people. Because remember, creative people also need to do research. So we work in the fashion work. I didn't get to show you, but it's available on YouTube. You can go look up IBM Research Fashion Designer. We work with fashion designers in Australia, in China, here in India. What they wanted to do was, they were still going to do the creative piece of designing new clothes, but they wanted to do research. What has been done? What color, what style has been used in the past? This is really, you know, and tens of years of even if they can't analyze. They used AI to analyze and ask design questions. Here is one where, I believe this was Fox. Fox Searchlight Pictures, they make lots of famous movies. They came to IBM and said, I've taken a movie called Marvin. I think it's a scary movie, so unfortunately I can't actually play the whole trailer for you here. I don't know the alien, so I just can't even play the trailer. But what they told us was, look, we go through a lot of time to create a trailer. Trailer is typically 30 seconds, 1 minute, 1.5 minutes, sort of a big movie of 2.5 hours. So they said, can your AI create trailers? And what was their motivation? Their motivation was they wanted to create different types of trailers. They wanted to create a trailer that was really scary. They wanted to create another trailer that showed all the emotional content. The girl was rescued. They wanted to show a third trailer which was all the focus was on the fantastic music. They wanted to create a fourth trailer that was more around the imagery. And they said, look, it takes a lot of time because a 2-hour video, our folks take a lot of time. Can you create an AI tool to help us make trailers? And essentially, that's what this wanted. So I'm going to play this, watch what happened with the... With this... Oh, unfortunately, it looks like... This
won't work right now. I'll show you a different example, same kind. You can look this up online, go look at Morgan trailer. You will see a trailer produced by AI. There is no human being involved in that trailer. I'll tell you what the AI did. AI took every screen and it learned to tag the screen as scary, horrendous, emotional, loud music, drama, etc. And it basically, now you could look at the movie and say, I want a scene which shows this young girl in a very horrifying situation, and it will give you back that. All you have to do is just stitch it together. you don't have to draw them to the movie. And so basically it was, the trailer was not fully constructed by the AI, but by the AI and human working. So is here the AI doing creative stuff? I don't know, you tell me. But the point is that this kind of creative stuff is happening.
I'll show you a different example. This is from God.
We are working to figure out how automatically highlights can be generated by AI. Now, to generate highlights, what you have to do? What you are seeing on the right hand side is the output from AI. What it is doing is, it is taking this segment of 30 seconds and classifying it based on what's the excitement level? Are people jumping? What's the momentous event? Are you focusing on the player? Are we focusing on this? And what you can do is look at the overall excitement level. It will analyze the emotion of the commentator. The commentator is saying, goal, fantastic, or you know, six or four, it means, okay, the commentator is getting very excited. What it lets you do is, lets you take 6 hours of a day's time. You can do this for cricket, you can do this for golf. You're doing this for golf right now by using that example. It allows you to take that and say, look, here are the snippets from which you likely want to create today's highlights. It will do upfront. And you can even do the following. I only want to create a Virat Kohli highlight. You can do that. You can say, only pick all the most interesting parts which involve Virat Kohli and where there was big cheer. They are automatically doing that. So today people are doing it. A lot of human beings are cutting and pasting the video. We can assist them. So imagine creating many, many highlights. Imagine creating not just one highlight package where somebody, Harsha Bogle, decided what you're supposed to see. No, I want to create a different highlight because that is a Virat Kohli fan, you are a Shikhar Dhawan fan, you can actually do that. Then you need AI to scale because I can't create 300 highlights with one human being. But if I have the AI can be told for a highlight. Again, what is the AI doing here? It is understanding data. Given this, it understands what's happening on the screen at the audio level, the video level, the image level, itself.
So, I would give you the following. A challenge is, list some tasks that you think are creative tasks, but an AI could help. And what would you want the AI to do? How would you want the AI to help a creative person?
This can be a music composer, a designer, highlight, pick whatever you think is creative. There are actually interesting examples, by the way, of how AI has been used to curate even museums. It's making judgment call on TV. And so there are many, many use cases, but I think it is an interesting exercise because I think that's going to be a future wave of even creative tasks. So it's a worthwhile.
Alright, I think I'm going to move on from AI. I have five, I'm almost out of time. I'm going to take 2 minutes if you don't mind, just to talk a little bit about quantum computing. Because I think it's interesting and I think young minds are the good ones to talk to about quantum computing.
Before I do that, if you had asked me what are big four technologies that we are all interested and amazed and interested about, there are four. I only talked about this today. Some of you might have heard the word blockchain, that's another interesting one. This one, and then I'll come to quantum computing. I just listed these four because I think if you are curious about technology, it will be useful for you to track what's happening in each of these. The reason I mentioned security is, you saw what we said about AI, right? We started AI not by talking about some equation or an algebra or not. We talked about AI starting with data. Same with blockchain. Quantum is a little bit different. And what's happening in the world today is, if you are going to do so much on data, keeping data secure becomes really important. All of you already know about cyber hacking, people stealing other people's identity, people stealing other people's rights in the news all the time. So I think new and innovative ways to keep data safe are going to be really important, are going to be an emerging area with a lot of potential. Let me ask one question. How many people know this notion of encryption? You guys know what encryption is? Okay. You in the red shirt. Can you explain to me how encryption works? Not an algorithm, but give me an example of how you think encryption works.
Suppose you want to log into your Yahoo or something, or email or something, so that some other hackers do not encrypt into your, do not see your password. So what the system does is, when you type your password, it changes it into a or asterisks or dots, so that the hacker cannot, does not understand what it is about. And as they're receiving it, the device again decrypts the decrypts it into the real password, and then you can log in.
Okay. So, and at some level, encryption means that I take this password in that example, able to send it in a way that nobody else can see it, but only the server on the other side can decrypt. Now, all of these things work by exploiting what we think is a really hard problem. For example, all of you know what factorization is. Take a big number, break it into. Now, it turns out that factoring huge numbers is a complex problem. So it's easy to take something like 72, you can say 9 and do it quickly. But imagine taking a number which has 200 digits. It's very, very hard to factor. However, if I give you the factors, it's very easy to multiply and check that this multiplication yields that number. So one way in which we do encryption and how these things actually work is by exploiting the fact that that password, however I send it, for somebody to crack it, they must be able to factorize a big number. And since factorizing a big number is hard, they can't do it, only the server is able to check, because the server already knows how. All the server on the other side has to multiply and check it is correct. It says, okay, come the right password. So what are we doing? We are exploiting the fact that some problems are really hard even for computers. However fast, how many computers you have, if I give you a 300-digit number, is very, very hard to factorize. We are exploiting that for security. And every encryption algorithm you use today, whenever you go to your browser and see that little lock on the side which says it is a secure site, using some form of encryption. The problem is, as we have more computers, and there are many other problems, not just this, and when something like quantum computing starts to happen, a problem that you think is hard today is no more hard. So then what do you do? If I was depending on the fact that factorizing a problem is hard, what if a quantum computer for it actually conservative. Then that security doesn't work anymore. All it requires is for the guy who didn't have access to a quantum computer. I'm not saying it will happen, but in the next 5 to 8 years, chances are you're going to have that. So a lot of interesting work is starting to go on, essentially to find new hard problems. What are hard problems that are going to be hard even for quantum computers to solve, so that I can now continue to do cryptography. And then the other problem people are looking at is, can I do useful things with data completely without decrypting the data? This is interesting because imagine the following. I want to know whether a particular type of genetic makeup is going to cause you are prone to, let's say, a heart attack or some disease. It's useful to be able to get that information, because then I can know who is at risk and provide them the right advisory information, either health or medicine or etc. But obviously, your genetics is very sensitive information. You're not going to share it around with everybody. So what would it not be powerful if I could keep a big table of your genes and whether or not and I can store it encrypted. I never decrypt it, but I can still compute on it. I can compute an average, I can compute a median, I can compute some other correlation. Because to do AI, that's all I need to do. I don't need to look at every one of them. Can I compute statistics? Can I learn from the data without decrypting the data? Answer is yes, you can. In fact, it's been proved that you can do all the computations of the world completely unencrypted data. It's just that it's super slow, not practical. So a lot of work is going on here to understand how to work with it. So two areas that it would be lovely for you guys to learn. How encryption works today, because it's going to be very, very important, even for AI. Because more and more interesting AI on sensitive data, people will want to do with security taken into account. So how does encryption work today? What are the hard problems it depends on? What are some of those hard problems potentially threatened by quantum? And what are some of the new hard problems people are considering? That's one. Second is, how do people even think about working? Can I work with encrypted data? And the trick is, it's possible to do. How do I make it better? That's what's happening in security. Last on quantum computing. So, and with this I'm going to end. The reason I talk about quantum computing in a talk on AI is quantum computing has the potential. Much like it can break today's security, it can dramatically transform today's AI also. Now, but that's why I'm mentioning quantum computing. The other reason is that I think
You guys are going to find quantum computing easier than many of us others do. That I know. Because quantum computing is fundamentally a different way of thinking about computing. And those of us who have been doing the current way of thinking about computing find it hard to change after the easier for you guys to change. But let me ask the following question to understand quantum computing. And I have no idea of the current curriculum. Is quantum introduced at all in any of the grades here, quantum physics? Not really. Okay, so let me tell you what quantum computing starts with, and then I'm happy to talk about that. We all understand our traditional laws of physics, Newton's law, then Einstein came along, he invented special relativity, general relativity. So at the scale of big objects, from day-to-day objects to massive objects in the universe, we have theories like gravitation, electromagnetic the theory, explaining how the world works. But when we get to really, really, really small, subatomic, the equivalent theory in physics is called quantum. It's the accepted theory of how stuff behaves at really, really small scale. Now, the interesting part is, at really, really small scale, stuff behaves in a really strange way. For example, one principle of quantum computing is that you cannot know the perfect answer of something in the sense that when you observe it, the answer will change. It's like saying the following, there is a theory called uncertainty principle, Heisenberg's uncertainty. But that's one example of a bigger principle, which basically states that the system is actually in many, many states. When you observe it, it will give you one state and it will choose that somehow and give you, and that's all you will observe. And the question now is, can you use something that like that for a computer? Why would you want to use something like that for a computer? How does computing work today? Computing works today by representing everything as bits that take on two values, 1 and 0. We ignore how we create 1 and 0, whether we create it by semiconductors, voltage, whatever. We somehow create chips that allow us to represent lots and lots of 1s and 0s. And then on top of that, we are able to compute, and everything we do today from simple registrex machine to all this AI is based on 1 and 0. Now, quantum computing says, I will create something different. I'm going to create something called a qubit, not a bit. And the qubit, because of this kind of principle, has the property that it is not one, it can be in 0 or 1, but really it is in a whole combination of states that are a combination of 0 or 1. So just with one qubit, you don't only represent a 0 or 1, you represent a collection of possibilities. And then when you observe it, it will fall down to either 0 or 1. But while the system is functioning, it can do many, many more. So as an example, to tell you why this is very powerful,
what people are excited about is the following. I think this is the most important chart.
In traditional computing, suppose you want to say, I have a computer that has a power of 4. I want to create a computer that has power of 8, whatever that unit of power is. I have to double the number of transistors. That's the only way I know. Because I'm working still in 0 and 1. So I need a computer that's more powerful, I need to pack more transistors in. We have somehow managed to keep the computer smaller and smaller and smaller, but the fact is I still have to double. With quantum computing, if I can add one more qubit, I double. So imagine the power that today our computers store billions and billions of bits. But I can get to the compute power of billions of bits with tens to hundreds of qubits. Because adding every qubit doubles the power. So this is what we are very excited about. But these computers are not easy to build. They are barely getting built, but it's very powerful.
Now, just to give you a sense of why this is, I'm going to tell you this whole qubit then.
Ignore all the math. Think of a bit as being either south pole or north pole. Today, every bit can only be north pole or south pole. A qubit can be any part of this field. When you observe a qubit, it will give you back either 1 or 0. But while it is doing its computation, so this one qubit itself is able to represent all possible points on or within that field. That's why it is so much more powerful than it. The problem though is, because it works at such small scales, it's very hard to keep a qubit stable. We know how to keep a bit stable. We can keep a bit at 0 or 1 for a long time and keep measuring it, and we know how to keep it. Keeping a qubit stable is super hard. Today, a quantum computer is stable only for less than a few hundred microseconds. So you can only do stuff that you can do within 100 microseconds. After that, the qubit is not measurable because it gets affected by the environment. And even to keep it stable for 100 microseconds, the quantum computer is maintained today at a temperature that is colder than outer space. Because to avoid all that interference, you have to like block it off from literally everything. And the only way to block it off is to keep it cooling. So space age technology is used to keep the, I believe the chip is at like some ridiculous temperature. I know it's colder than outer space, I forget the temperature. And even then it is only stable for 100 microseconds. But with that too, you can do very powerful.
So, I want to just end with one example. Why are we very excited about quantum computing?
You recognize most of these compounds? Everybody recognizes this compound. Ethanol, alcohol, chemistry lab, acetaminophen, headache, fever, dolo, caffeine, black tea, chai, sucrose, sugar, penicillin, antibiotic. These are all simple molecules we do use today. Correct? We all use this today, we make products for this. Now, we have managed to create products without even fully understanding these molecules, just by experimenting. This is the number of bits an average today's computer needs to fully simulate these molecules. So, if we could create these many products with even sort of understanding these molecules, imagine what all the improvements we could fully understand these molecules. And these are all simple molecules. The world today uses many, many more complex molecules. But even these simple molecules, just look at caffeine, my favorite molecule. There is no computer in the world today that can fully simulate caffeine. Because I cannot build a computer with 10 to the power of 48. Do you realize how big 10 to the power of 48 is? I can't build a computer. But if I could build a qubit with just 160 qubits, that can simulate caffeine. So that's why this gets really. So we are really excited about computing because the ability, the power is enormous. However, the quantum computer is not going to be good at everything.
It's going to be good at something, not going to be good at everything. And with this, I'm going to end. Just another
scale. If I could build a quantum computer with 275 qubits, that is more than the atoms in the observable universe. So that's how big this quantum is. Just to give you a sense of the scale, I have no idea where we will build a computer like this. We are barely at 50 qubits now, and we know it's not going to be easy, but this is the potential.
And I will just end with this picture.
By the way, that's a picture of IBM's quantum computer. I don't think you even see the chip. The chip is like way at the bottom. There's a big chandelier, huge chandelier, which is all the cooling to keep the chip at the bottom. Really, really small chip at the bottom at that temperature. We are excited about chemistry, applications of quantum computing chemistry. Artificial intelligence, many of the algorithms we use today can be dramatically faster, potentially, with quantum computing. Then we are interested in that. So with that, I will end. I'm happy to take more questions. I was like all over the place, but hopefully you got a few questions.
So, what a wonderful inspirational lecture session this was. Not just for children, but actually for parents and teachers and all of us here. No one is coming from senior person from IBM, which has been the power of innovation for now all more than 100 years. Yeah? And many children you might be interested in knowing, you know, so many of the day-to-day things we take for granted all happen at IBM. For example, the ATM machine we use every day, invented at IBM. The credit card, Stripe we see at the back.
Barcodes.
Yeah, sorry.
Barcodes
back in my
office.
Yes, amazing, right? Yes. So, and it's not just one of the world's largest corporations, it's also one of the world's largest research organizations, and so many things. Getting down to the level of atoms. So amazing. And recently, last couple of weeks back, there was an announcement that IBM has made the largest ever software acquisition. They're planning to do that. They're going to be working with Red Hat, right? And creating. And so a lot of opportunities for you children. I mean, we saw the space that is there. So thank you once again for this amazing lecture, very interactive and very promising for children. I would like to thank the school again for arranging this at such short notice, and for the children and parents to show up within probably just a few hours of announcement. And thanks to the NIAS support staff, thanks to the school support staff for making this happen. Yeah, now we have questions. Please use the opportunity to probe into Mr. Sriram's mind and get as much of that as possible.
Are you using
Sriram Raghavan
as a transmission for imagination and dreaming?
Imagination and dreaming. We haven't quite figured that out, but we just haven't figured that out. Here is what I would say. I think that artificial intelligence will be used to definitely understand human beings better and better. What I mean by that is, and I was actually talking to, mentioning this offline, to understand our body, we are able to take x-rays, MRI, scan, go, get blood out, and we know. And we do not understand the body completely, but at least we have more probes to understand the body. We have much fewer to touch the brain, right? For good reason, we don't put that many probes into the brain that we are able to poke into the rest of the body. So the only way to understand the brain, and I am extrapolating from imagination and dreams to understanding what's going on, the only way to understand the brain is to understand it by the output of the brain. What is the output of the brain? Is what you draw, what you speak, what you create, what you write. That's the way I am going to understand the brain. Which basically means understanding images, text, etc. So, I do think that AI will, whether it will allow me to deconstruct dreams, I don't know. Whether it will let me understand human beings better, I think it's definitely going to be. There are a lot of research scientists looking at how to use words and images produced by, like for example, dyslexic children or autistic children, to understand whether you can predict that they are that something is going to happen by looking at what they write. Can you provide instances of where, you know, for example, depression based on what people are writing? People are working on that. People are looking at whether analyzing the behavior of a human being, you can predict that this is old people, can this is likely to be a case of Parkinson. Just like the potato blight, if instead of knowing that this person is afflicted by Parkinson when they are already afflicted by Parkinson, if I could give a heads up of a few years, I can take back the action. Today, the heads up of a few years is almost impossible to do. Because even if you go to a doctor, how often can you go to a doctor? Once a month? Once every 4 months? Whereas, I could monitor your behavior constantly through the sensors in the house. And if I can build AI, I can give you advanced knowledge. So, I think short answer is, AI will be used to better understand human beings, maybe including dreams at some point. But I think the near term impact is actually much more around health. Health and personal security has a lot of that.
So, will AI make us dumber and
will
AI take over everything what we do?
This is always a hard question. I did expect it. To be honest, I don't think we know. So, I don't think it's going to make you dumber. It is like anything else, it's what we choose to do. We as, and you are all citizens of tomorrow, so you are all going to be making decisions on what we use AI for, what not we use AI for. Does AI have the potential, if badly used, to destroy society? Yes. But if rightly used, does it have the potential to transform society? Absolutely yes. So, I think it's upon all of us to understand its power, know when to use it, know when not to use it. And people are talking about it. There is a lot of effort around this notion of responsible use of AI. And people are asking, and it's a very hard question, because the same technology that I use to understand you, I can use it to help you or I can use it to hurt you. Correct? So it's very hard to say. Is the potential there? You're absolutely right. The other question, I don't know whether that was part of your question, is in terms of things like, oh, if AI does anything, do I have any job, do I have any work, right? Often people ask. I would not be worried about that for the next 40 years. There are many, many, many jobs that AI can, are very, very hard to do for them still. However, I would still say the following, that jobs that look like they are very repetitive and you're doing the same thing and over and again, chances are an AI is going to start doing it. But you're going to have other jobs to do. The other jobs will be, these AIs don't show up on their own. They are not like you plant a seed, you can pop out an AI. You have to train data, you have to label them, you have to teach them a domain. Those are all things only human beings can do. It is just that you don't have to do the boring job. Instead, you teach something to do that boring job for you, but the job of teaching is still left over for a human being. So that's the way I would teach.
So what is the, like, what do you call the application of AI in the medical field?
Medical field, okay, I skipped that chart. Many applications going on. One area, I'll tell you one that we are working on is radiology medicine. So there's a project at IBM called Medical Sim, you can look it up. The challenge we are trying to solve there is, can we create an AI that is almost as good as a radiologist? So which is the guy who examines the images coming out of your X-ray and MRI and says, okay, there is something wrong, there is not something wrong. Now that analysis has two problems today. One, human beings have to do it, which means you have to keep training human beings. And there are far more people with more disease and more scans than they are able to train radiologists. Number two, human beings undergo fatigue. We know by practice that radiologists make mistakes. The same radiologist looking at pictures, by the end of the evening, 5 PM, he's going to make more mistakes than he's going to make a day again. But we're all just getting tired. So, teaching, and goes back to image. We taught it to understand satellite images. We taught it to understand fashion images. We are teaching it to understand radiologists. To do diagnostics. Second area in healthcare is, there is so much research going on in healthcare that even doctors are not able to keep up. So in very advanced diseases, this is not for your average cold, common, fever and so on, but think of cancer, think of Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, which we don't understand well, where the understanding of the disease is changing on a day-to-day basis because experiments are going on all over the world. Papers are being written, trials are being conducted. Even the best doctor in a best hospital just cannot keep up with all that happening. So the second use of AI we are working on is, can the AI constantly keep track of all this? And then in the context of a patient, can it bring the relevant information in front of the doctor? The AI is not yet ready to diagnose, not going to make a recommendation. But it can at least tell the doctor, based on the results of the patient, his background, his genomics, all of these things, here are the most recent advances, these experimental drugs, this trial, that you should consider. Because without the AI, the doctor has no way of keeping up. One data point, there is, I believe, either 100 or 1,000 articles on cancer being published every year. I don't know of anybody who is a working doctor who can keep up with something like that while doing their data. So, assisting doctors in diagnosis is another way. Just two examples, there are many more.
On YouTube, there are many videos on how AI will be really great in 2050 and everything. Like how there will be like space indicators and everything. That's just because they say it. But do you think that actually will be true? Like they say they can upload memories and brain actually when you're there, they can put into an AI and then last will be given. Do you think that's true?
Yeah, so I think. It's not true right now for sure, but I think the bigger challenge there is not the AI, is in the level of understanding of the brain. We don't have anywhere close to the depth of a model of the brain that we should have. I believe the best, at least last I kept track, people are trying, but the closest we have been able to get to do is to do a simulation of a rat's brain that is about 60-70% fidelity. There's a long way to go from a rat's brain to a human's brain. So, I think so that's the challenging part. It's not the technology to upload it, store it, yeah, we can do it. But do we have the technology to actually create a model of the brain? We are decades away from that. But it's a great area to work, and maybe when we solve it, then this brief problem will also disappear.
I would like to come back to what I was trying to do. So, you said that there's a long way to go, but it is possible that at one time when AI can become smarter than human beings. And IBM itself has made this technology that defeated the world chess champion. So, what is that gives such a negative effect on our society that AI is kind of going surpassing all our powers and maybe just degrading our own human brain level?
So, your question is about why do we have a negative sentiment?
More about that, how is AI just degrades our own human parts that we feel that we're not good enough?
No, okay. So, let me go back to one of my previous statements, right? I think this whole model of competition itself is wrongly thought about. So think of the AI as going to move more and more from the spectrum of it does a job I don't want to do, to it does a job that I'm doing today but it's really boring. boring and repetitive, it can do it with less mistakes, etc. Two, it will assist me even in some of my more interesting intelligent jobs. And all that's going to be true and it's going to continue to happen. Now, whether it will replace you or not is less about the technology, what we design. You could decide that, like for example, today we do not let the AI do diagnosis and final decision making. For many reasons, not just because it is not perfect, but because the AI is not capable of taking all other considerations into account. Remember that in life or death situations, what you prescribe is not just medicine, but you look at the family situation, their history. The AI is not ready to understand human society at that level. So right now, I would say, even if it was perfect in diagnosis, it would not be the final decision maker a human being from. Now, could we make the wrong choices and give it more remit than it is deserving? It is, but we have done that in the past. We have done that with other technologies before. We have misused technologies before. So I go back to, I think it is less about the technology. This is about where we decide to put bounds around the technology. And you don't even have to go far into things like, will it destroy society, will it take over jobs. Even today you could do it to bad use of technology. I'll give you this example. And a lot of us are very conscious about this. There's something called bias in AI. Now, and it's very easy to understand bias in AI. So imagine that you are you landed from Mars and I plonk you in the middle of the Sahara Desert. And I put a wall over the Sahara Desert. You can only observe the human beings there only within that wall. You cannot get around. And what model of human beings you develop, that model of human beings will assume that all human beings are dark skinned. Correct? On the other hand, I draw the same, because what model you develop is based on the data you see around you. AI does the same thing. You drop a Martian in the middle of Germany, chances are to them they will think the modern human beings are all white skinned and fair. Now, how do you use AI? You also give data to the AI to train the data. What people have observed is, if you are not conscious about how you collect the data you give to an AI model, the AI model will also be biased. So today, many AI models that recognize faces do super well for white people, do sort of well for brown people, do really, really badly. Their accuracy is really poor for dark people. So the answer is not that, there is something that AI is a bad human being or a bad AI. It is the data that you get. So I think even now we have an opportunity to think about sensible uses of AI. And a lot of us are working at, how do you do this? How do you make sure that the data that you give an AI is not biased along dimensions that society is believing you should not discriminate on? We believe you should not discriminate on gender, race, various other categories. But the AI will discriminate if you don't tell it not to discriminate. So right here is something you can learn about good use of technology. And if it is important today, those questions become super important and the AI becomes more and more powerful. I'll just end with this, that I, to your, it's a long one answer to your question, but this discussion is not new. You remember my chat about all those revolutions that happened and we talked about? People have asked this of every revolution. And in every revolution, we have made some good choices and we have made some bad choices. Sometimes we don't know that we have made a bad choice until it's too late. Industrial revolution, steam engine, today we worry about climate pollution, energy safety. So, I think the only difference here is, those revolutions all took about 50 to 100, 150 years to really happen. And they usually measure that revolution by growth in GDP. So they say that revolution is typically, I believe, doubling or tripling of world GDP. That's what they mean. This was a revolution because the world looked like this. And then within 75 years, the world, the GDP has tripled. I think what's happening is, this is happening so fast. So this revolution is probably going to triple world GDP in half the time. And so therefore, I think we have to be even more conscious of responsible use of technology. Because just like the bad impact can take 50, 60 years, in this case, the revolution is faster, the bad impact will show up tomorrow. Suddenly, we willy-willy deploy AI everywhere without understanding its use, it may be too late, you might even pull that. So as some of you, as many of you as young citizens, while you understand the technology, constantly think about the principles behind its use. The principles could be security of data, could be privacy, ownership, controls around when to use AI, when not to use AI. I think these are all really, really important cross-disciplinary discussions that you know, children should be having.
Like, can we have real-life conversations with AI in the future?
You could. People have been trying to do that for a while. Even today, you figure out pretty quickly it's not a smart human being on the other side. I think, rather than the question whether we could, I think we could. Do we want to? That is, the bigger question. And I don't know if you guys know this thing called a Turing test? Okay. So that is, by the way, how Alan Turing, who is the father of computing, his definition of, he invented this Turing test where one of his things was, I put a wall and I do conversation. He didn't specify whether I was doing WhatsApp or texting or chatting, but he just said, I put a wall, there is something with the other I'm interacting with. If in interacting with it, I can't distinguish whether it is a machine or a human being, then that is supposed to have passed this Turing test. Now, we haven't built anything that passes the Turing test, except in very artificial considerations. And the reason is very simple. All that AI today is narrow. So, I could put a really smart thing in front of you that can wax eloquent with you about one topic. All it takes is for you to go to a slightly different topic, you will figure out from the response that that's where we are.
Sometime back, you said that everything, this technology always improves really fast. So how long do you think AI will stay, and what do you think will be the next big technology after AI?
So I think we already touched upon quantum computing, right? I think that's going to be big. I think it's less about AI staying or not. It's not as if the previous technology have not stayed. Hard disk storage, they all stored, right? So previous revolution, industrial revolution, we still have cars and automobiles. So you're going to keep adding. I think AI will be there for a very, very long time to come. The way we do AI may get dramatically transformed. Via technology like quantum computing and who knows what will be coming in there. So AI is going to be there for a long time because at that level, AI is about making sense of data. That is so fundamental. It has been with us. It has been with us already. We just don't realize it. It's just getting to a point where it is shocking us today. But it's going to continue to be there.
So you said that AI does more and more boring tasks. So with the population increase, do you think that AI is leading to unemployment?
Yes, there is a. It is. AI is going to lead to job transformation. That is for sure. Whether it leads to unemployment or not is really a societal question, it's not a technology question, right? So, it will lead to job transformation because it will be easier, more efficient, faster, cheaper for a certain job to be done by an AI than a human being. The challenge is going to be that there are these other jobs that the human beings should start doing. The big difference between the AI revolution and the previous revolution is because they happened over a 100-year period, you had a few generations to change your skill. If you are like somebody whose family did weaving looms and you had the industrial revolution, it is not as if in 5 years all the looms went away and you know you got industrial looms. It took few decades for it to happen. That allowed room for people to change their skill learning. The biggest challenge we are facing, so that I don't have an answer, I don't think anybody has an answer, is this stuff is happening so fast. It is much harder to physically replace physical technology, but this technology is so digital that you are able to roll it out at planet scale. Between an idea and rolling it out at planet scale is 6 months. Now if your idea is going to suddenly take away 100 types of jobs, people can't learn new skills that quickly. That's the biggest challenge we are running into. So as you guys think about uses of AI, it will be fantastic if you constantly think about how to use AI in that world also. Maybe here's another challenge. Can you think of interesting uses of AI in the world of skilling and learning and education? There are people trying to do it. But if you wanted to have an AI help you in learning a new skill, what would you want the AI to do? So I think that we should continue to think about.
A lot of this lecture is about benefits of AI and what AI can do. What can AI fundamentally not do?
Good question.
What is something that only humans can do and not yet?
Good question. Here is why this the question is an ill-posed question, because you will find it hard to even define what it is a human being cannot do. We can describe it in physical terms. You may today tell me a human being cannot run at a million miles a second. Fair enough. You can make an object do a million things, you are not able to run a million miles a second. But with AI, we typically don't worry about physical, right? We're talking about mental computation. And today we don't know even the limits of humanity. We don't know what it is that a human brain can and cannot do. So in the absence of that definition, I have no way to know what it is an AI can and cannot do. Because I would tell you this, we don't have a formal model of what a human brain computes, right? So if I had a formal model, I could say, okay, that model has this power, and here is this other model, this has more power. And I'm able to state about bits and qubits, because I have a model of what it is it can and it cannot do. Today, we don't have a formal model of the human brain at all. We really don't know, which is why all of you are different, all of you have different capacities. There are people who do amazing in one dimension, not in the other. And I think we are exactly like that today. Today, we are only able to create AI as a function of the data and the compute. We don't know what are all the possible sources of data and possible compute algorithms that will give AI what our power is for. There is no formalism around it. So nobody knows how to answer. So I would challenge you to see whether you think there is a way to actually put a bound on the human brain. And if you could do that, that will be interesting on its own right, independent of artificial intelligence. We just don't know. The other challenge I would give you is we're constantly struggling. We talk about artificial intelligence, human intelligence. One dimension we never talked about is the use of energy and power. So remember all this image recognition I told you, this whether it is fashion or satellite or whatever. I can put you on one of these balconies upstairs and I can give you a constant stream of people walking by. And you would constantly do it, and you would recognize, that's my aunt, this is my uncle, this is my teacher. You do it naturally without thinking about it, right? Now you are doing some really high-scale, real-time video recognition. And your brain, for everything it is doing, is only using 25 watts. You're probably not even using all of the 25 watts. You could be playing a video game on the side and still doing image recognition. You're probably using a fraction of 25 watts to do that image recognition. We're nowhere close to that. These computers expend a lot of energy. So if we could understand the human brain better to design more energy efficient systems, it will be very, very powerful. So your brain doesn't require the amount of charge that our iPhone. Every night you have to plug it in to do that much energy for it to start doing Face ID every day next month. You don't require that. You consume way less energy. That's a great challenge.
Sir, don't you think if there's a lot of AI, it's going to be like because of overpopulation, there is less space, and because of a lot of AI, artificial intelligence, there is going to be a lot of space consumed. And then, do you think AI will mimic what the trees do, make normal air into oxygen? How is it going to help for us to breathe them later?
So you're drawing a link between AI and space. I'm not able to get that link.
Like as in, if there's a lot of space consumed, where do you think they're going to live? And there won't be trees also, right? Because there's a lot of space consumed, and do you think it will help?
We have a power issue, we don't have a space issue right now. With AI, there is no statistics that says because of AI, we are building suddenly occupying more land. The danger we will have though is energy consumption. That is true. But that is true independent of AI. I think our energy problem is much worse. And it has nothing to do with AI. If anything, I'm hopeful of AI maybe being a solution to the problem. Energy consumption is a big issue, not land use. And that just goes back to the fact that as AI becomes more popular, people are wanting to do more AI, which means people want more data centers with more computers. How are all the data centers run? They are run with electricity. Where does electricity come from? Coal. That is where this. It is not directly because of AI. The only argument you could make is, as AI becomes better and better, people are going to use digital technologies more and more. That's already happening. I think the interesting question to ask is, can we use AI to address some of the issues? Can we use AI to better understand climate models? People are doing that. But I personally don't believe that answer to those big problems is only technology. This is cultural change. Cultural change, societal change, which is much harder. If you could build persuasive AI systems, that would be fantastic. Could you convince, could you build, instead of asking an AI system that can fake be a human being, can you build AI system that can persuade you to, you know, do plastic, do the right thing, conserve? I think that would be fantastic. And maybe that is a good use of AI to be to people. Because people are fundamentally very bad at this. People are fundamentally bad at long range plans. People are like, climate change, somebody else will take care of it, will come 40 years later, right? So that's the worry that a lot of people have. I don't see a direct connect. I see it more as a possible piece of the solution as opposed to the solution.
That day I saw a video on YouTube where a news reporter was fake by a deep fake.
Sorry, you were saying what again?
A news reporter was replicated by an AI for deep fake, and they could make him say whatever he wants, and it looked really realistic. So, how can we differentiate between fake and real news? And this can have a huge effect on politics. And
I agree. It is a big issue, and it goes back again to rightful use of the technology. There is no answer there. This is our biggest role as human beings, may start to become not just building the technology, but to constantly make decisions on the use of the technology. So I didn't get a chance to show this. You talk about news. News is at least mostly summarizing and delivering facts. IBM has built this thing, experimental technology called Debater. Go look it up. I don't know if you've seen. Remember we built a system that beat the Jeopardy game, right? It beat the latest champion. So we built a system now called Debater that competed against human debaters. You go see the video, it is hilarious. That thing is able to make fun of you, debate, pass judgment, it will listen to you, and it's a full-fledged debate. You come here and speak for 4 minutes, the system will listen to you, you make certain points, it will come back and counter your points. Now again, you can use it right, badly or correctly. You can use the debater to say, I am only going to communicate a particular point of view and flash that debater, put it in the app everywhere and confuse everybody. Or you can use it for really debating real issues about humanity, everything from, you know, climate change. What you use it for is our choice. So rather than again asking the question, can we distinguish between a fake news reporter and a real news, I would ask the question, do we want AI-powered news reporters? If so, why not? Do I want AI to assist news reporters in filtering truth? Maybe. But is it that important for the AI to be the one as the mouthpiece? I don't know. So I think it's all about asking, you guys are all asking a very common theme, and I don't think anybody has the right answer, which is, we know how to build this stuff, where should we use it or not use it? And it's an excellent question with no obvious answer.
So now suppose we search in Google or something, it more like sometimes in some of the websites when you click, they ask before you see the information, they are you a robot or not? And if you click yes, they are. But before you started this presentation, you said that with artificial intelligence we can program them for object detection and everything. So when they say you are not a robot, they will give those pictures, they will say, so show where there are no parking boards and all. So even the robots can do it, then what's the
issue? Yes, in fact, what is happening, they have to constantly upgrade those systems. When they first, these systems are what is called CAPTCHA. And they were originally, and just like I, you remember I talked about encryption, they invented CAPTCHA as a way to say, how do I distinguish between bots and human beings? I'm going to give a hard task that I think only a human being can do, a bot cannot do. And unfortunately, that line continues to get more. Previously, they could simply give what they used to do, things like give a fuzzy looking character recognition. They would give a slanted A, messed up. AI got better and better at recognition, so they stopped using that, they moved on to something else. They will constantly, now I know that I believe IRCTC tries to give you a formula. But the formula is encoded in an image in such a way that the hope is the AI, so it will look something very simple like 4 plus 3 equal to question mark, and all human beings will say 7. The claim is that image has 4 plus 3 encoded in a way that you can see it, but the bot sees it, it can't pull out 4 and 3 easily. But that's just somebody put enough compute power, they will crack the problem, they will have taken over. That's what's happening. So you are right. When you design those CAPTCHAs today, you have to make them more and more robust against what AI can do today. And as AI can do more and more, you have to keep making it harder and harder.
Okay, with that, we...
Can I take one question?
To give it to the children, we have coffee at the end for that. So with that, we'll end with a huge applause.
For thanking Sriram for coming and giving us such a beautiful lecture. I think for all of us, there are a lot of questions. There are several more questions as adults and children that we can think about. And I think it has been a great way to launch the lecture series. I hope we'll be able to hear many more interesting lectures during the day. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.